Hey everyone, Noah Zerbe here. This is one of a series of short videos where we look at variations on the prisoner's dilemma or in game theory in international relations. This video deals specifically with the hawk-dove problem, sometimes known as the game of chicken. In other videos, we look at the prisoner's dilemma itself as well as other variations in game theory, so you may want to look at those videos as well. But if you're ready, let's get started with the game of chicken. You're probably already familiar with the game of chicken. We see it play out in lots of situations in the movies, standoff where each side waits for the other to back down. Two cars barreling towards one another at high speed, careening towards a head-on collision. The question is, who will flinch? Who will blink first? The one who does is called the chicken, and the one who doesn't wins the game. We see examples of this all the time. Footloose, there are two tractors in a standoff. In The Hunt for Red October, it's two nuclear-powered submarines. But the classic example of this is probably a scene from the 1955 James Dean film Rebel Without a Cause. One of the most famous scenes from that film involves Jim, played by James Dean, and Buzz, his rival gang leader, played by Corey Allen, challenging one another to a game of chicken. They'll race towards a cliff, and the first one to swerve or jump out of their car is the chicken and loses the game. What happens? Let's see.
You okay?
Yeah, give me some dirt. Hey, Toreador. She signals, we head for the edge. And the first man who jumps is a chicken. All right? Judy?
Me too.
Hmm?
May I have some dirt, please?
Thank you.
So what happens in that scene? Buzz wins the game of chicken, but dies in the attempt as his car careens over the cliff's edge. Now, there's a couple of points to make with respect to that scene, but let's come back to that in a moment. First, let's look at the game of chicken in game theoretic terms. If we graph our choices in a payoff matrix, we arrive at something like this. My first or most preferred outcome would be for me to go straight and for my opponent to swerve. I win the game of chicken. But note that my least preferred outcome, by a long shot, would be for neither of us to swerve. In that case, our cars crash head-on, or I drove over the cliff, and we're both likely dead. Not an outcome I'd like to see at all. My second preferred outcome would be for both of us to swerve, hopefully in opposite directions. This means there's no winner. I save face, but no one dies. So, how is this resolved? Where's the Nash equilibrium? That's the problem with this game. Because the loss of swerving is so trivial compared to the crash that occurs if we both fail to swerve, I might rightly assume that my opponent will swerve and decide not to myself. But my opponent may make the same decision. Because of this, the game of chicken is sometimes called an anti-coordination game, because unlike in classical coordination games, we don't always mutually benefit by coordinating strategies.
We're turning straight at him. Torpedoes still on our tail.
The hard part about playing chicken is knowing when to flinch.
Collision in 400 yards, 350, 300, tap then.
Right full rudder, 30 degree down angle.
Aye, sir.
This one's gonna be close!
You are an ass. You've killed us.
What does this have to do with international relations? The Hawk-Dove game is directly applicable to the challenge of brinksmanship, the idea of securing an advantageous outcome by pushing dangerous events to the brink of crisis and forcing your opponent to back down. And we see many examples of this during the Cold War, including the Berlin blockade and the Cuban Missile Crisis, in which both sides continued to escalate the stakes until one was forced to back down by the other. And more broadly, the idea of mutually assured destruction is at its heart a game of chicken. As we consider in another video, mutually assured destruction is the idea that an attack by either the United States or the Soviet Union against the other would be responded to with a full-scale nuclear strike, destroying both countries and likely the entire world in the process. Just as with the game of chicken, each side would prefer to get their way and have the other side back down, but both sides would prefer to avoid the threat of mutually assured destruction. Finally, negative externalities can also be viewed from the Hawk-Dove game, where coordinated strategies, that is, avoiding conflict, can yield to a more favorable outcome. Now, the challenges of ensuring coordination in the Hawk-Dove problem can be addressed through several mechanisms. In addition to the various strategies that can be employed to overcome the prisoner's dilemma, which we can consider in another video, we might use signaling to show resolve or lack thereof. In the classic game of chicken, I might lock my door or handcuff myself to the steering wheel, showing that I'm unwilling to back down and will drive over the cliff before swerving. In the case of nuclear war, a country might sign treaties that demonstrate their commitment to a specific region or the defense of a specific country. We can also use commitment devices to increase the cost of a particular course of action. Remember that commitment devices are tools that increase or decrease the cost of a particular course of action, making them more or less likely. In the case of chicken, the handcuffs I might use are a commitment device. In the case of nuclear weapon, a country might automate its response to take any decision-making out of the process altogether. Think of the Doomsday Machine from the movie Dr. Strangelove. So that concludes our very brief overview of the Hawk-Dove problem and the game of chicken in international relations. Be sure to watch the other videos in the series which explore other variations in game theory, including the stag hunt and the volunteer's dilemma. Thanks for watching. Have a good day. Bye.